up here. Get a mind on the Lord. Boy, I tell you, it's been good this week.
Yes, it has.
Amen. It's fantastic last night. Really was.
Yes, it was.
God's word is good. Let's all look to Him right now. Father, we are thankful to be gathered together in Your name, O God. Bless us tonight, we pray. If You lift us up above the shadows, O God, anoint us and help us to receive with gladness the engrafted words which is able to save our souls. And bless us everywhere, O God, that's gathered together in Your name tonight. We thank You for it, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Well, it is good to be in the house of God. Glad you're able to be here. Praise the Lord. We want to sing, get our mind upon the Lord.
Sister Bobby.
About
any time.
There you go. Have a play.
She's
seen
her.
Seen her drive by.
You seen her go by?
Yeah. Hello, Lord.
$5.
Yeah.
Well, it's
$10 a ring.
$10.
Yeah.
I was before church. Come on.
Well, since he's as big as he is, we'll just let it go.
That's probably the mayor.
Yeah, that's the mayor talking in.
Makes 125. He keeps me singing.
He certainly does.
There's within my heart. Glory to His name.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, you can overcome. Thank you.
Give you a helping hand, or be there to understand.
NIV says, "Dear friend, I pray that you may enjoy good health and that all may go well with you, even as your soul is getting along well." I believe the King James says, "Beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospered." We'll talk tonight about what it takes to be a success in Christianity. What it takes to be a success in being a Christian. There's a lot of things that we Christians need to stay on top of that get by us. Do you know, I'm convinced that the food we eat, the growth hormones that they're putting in food and stuff, I'm convinced that's why people are getting so huge nowadays. Do you know what the average age for a young girl to come into puberty is? 7 years old. 7 years of age. That seems unreal, doesn't it?
Yes, it does.
They're just babies. Just babies. During mission school, we had a couple there from India. You know, different people have different ways of doing things.
Absolutely.
In India, when a mother gives birth to a child, the placenta stays attached for 3 days. Doctors don't even know how the children survive, because it puts poison into their system. And they have yet to figure out why they do it, what the purpose is. But there's all kinds of things around us that are different from us.
Absolutely.
You say, well, what's that got to do with tonight? It's got a lot to do with tonight. Because if there's one thing that God wants us to be, it's a success.
Amen.
Because your success brings Him glory.
Amen.
Hmm? Yeah. Now, I'm not talking about dollars and cents. I'm not talking about that. You can be a very poor individual
and be
very successful.
Absolutely. Amen.
Matter of fact, there are a lot of folk that don't have money that are more successful than people who do have money.
Amen.
I believe that success counts how you treat a person.
Amen.
See, John was writing this letter to his good friend Gaius. Gaius was faced with some problems in the church, and there was a man by the name of Diotrephes who was causing problems, and he didn't want John to come. He was totally against John communicating with them in any way, shape, or form. So John wrote this to Gaius, and he said, "I wish above all things that you must prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospered." I believe it's in Joshua chapter 1, verse number 8, it says, and I'm paraphrasing, but it says, "Let not the book of this law depart out of your mouth. Meditate it on day and night, to observe to do accordingly to all that is written therein. And then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success." So the whole idea of this is, in whatever lifestyle you're in, God wants you to be successful. Of course, I'm talking about the kingdom now. I'm not talking about sin and all that stuff. With whatever habits that are in that particular lifestyle. How many know everybody lives the same way in their home?
Amen.
We all got different things that we do, different ways that we do things. Doesn't make them right, doesn't make them wrong. It just makes them the way we do things. We've all come from different kind of backgrounds. We've all got a story about our background. Some of them are good, and some of them are not so good.
That's right.
Some of them taught us some good lessons to stay away from some bad stuff. Amen. Some of us loved our parents coming up, and some of us had parents that were awful to us coming up. You never know what pain an individual is going through.
That's true.
You never know the taste that is in their mouth and the thoughts that are in their minds. That's why you got to be careful how you treat somebody.
That's right, man.
Huh? What's a good word to you may be a bad word to them.
Yes.
Come on now. What you consider going well is not going so well for them. You know, there are people in this world who are perfectionists. Everything's got to be done just so-so. And they expect it from themselves and everybody else. There's people who are inspectors. They come in your home, and if there's anything at all out of order, they'll find it.
They'll find it in mine.
And they'll find it in ours, too. Or they come to church, and they look for things that are out of order. But here, John is talking about one individual being successful. So I want you to take this as a message just for you. Just for you. So what does it mean to have good success? Well, here's some things you can reach, and then we're going to talk about some things to do in order to get that. First of all, let me define success. It means the original results or the original outcome. It means a favorable or satisfactory outcome or result. That's success. Successful is coming about or taking place or turning out to be as one was hoped to be or hoped for. It's accomplishing a mission. Success is not avoiding disappointments or overwhelming odds, but is facing every obstacle and every setback with enough courage and determination to continue on. Success is becoming what God has created you to be.
Yes.
And utilizing the gifts and talents He has given you.
Amen.
What is success? Success is reaching a point in your life where you're no longer the tail, but you're the head. Success is coming to a point in your life where you're no longer beneath, but you're above. Success is coming to in the form of your life of realizing that no weapon against you that's formed against you can prosper. Success is coming to the realization that hell cannot prevail against you. Success is knowing that you're more than a conqueror.
Hallelujah.
Success is coming to the realization that he that is in you is greater than he that is in the world. And these are not words that create the success. It's heartfelt and heart know that brings the success to an individual.
Amen.
So what does it take on our journey in life to be of success? It's amazing to me how that we Christians want to fight the devil, and we can't overcome our own fleshly habits ourselves. Listen to me now. I don't want to make anybody mad, but listen. How can you war against a demon spirit when you can't even overcome the desire of the flesh? Think about it. Because I'm going to tell you something. I've got a lot of experience in exorcism and demonology and all that kind of stuff. Matter of fact, I told you last night, and I really didn't finish my story on it, but the girl that was the witch that came to Frankfurt that was trying to overthrow my ministry, she's trying her best to get a hold of me. And my daughter won't give her my phone number. Well, she pulled a quick one. She called this week, and she said, I'm counseling with some ministers, with a minister from Billy Graham's ministry. And she said, told Tracy, she said, would you have your dad call them and give them some stuff about my background? Now, her background is something else. She was involved in 17 human sacrifices. She did her first sacrifice when she was 5 years old, and it was her favorite bunny that she had raised. She dedicated her oldest son to Satan. They cut open a goat and placed him inside the goat and dedicated him to Satan. She got a rough background, tough background. And you battle against spirits like that, you better be able to overcome what your flesh is wanting to do. Are you hearing what I'm saying?
Amen, brother.
So she left a message, left a number with my daughter for me to call. I said, I ain't calling that number. That's a trick by her, because she's trying to get my phone number. And it seems like that every time my family gets to another level of breakthrough, she tries to contact us. Now, I'm not stupid. Get me once, and you may get me twice, but you're not going to get me the third time. It ain't going to happen. No, 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 it ain't going to happen. I know what she's up to. She wants me to make that phone call thinking that I'm calling the ministries of Billy Graham, only to end up calling her, and then she can get my phone number. You got to realize and understand just how sneaky the devil really is. He is not stupid.
No, he's not.
He is not a stupid foe. And matter of fact, he knows the word of God.
Absolutely.
I mean, you think about how evil he was, but he's not been evil all the time. He was the precious covering. He was the stones. He was bright and shining. He had wisdom that passed Daniel. He knew who he was. That got him in trouble because a proudful spirit got in him. Some way, somehow or another, he began to think, I'm above God and I can do more than God can do. When you get to the place in life where you think you don't need God to get you through little simple things, you'll eventually think you don't need him to get through some of the hard stuff either. So what is success? What does it take to make success? First of all, success is followed by the choices and decisions you make. Since we've mentioned politics some this week, it's amazing. I mean, they're not doing it quite as much now as they have been doing it. But did you notice when Obama first took office, everything he blamed on Bush? Everything. I'm not saying George Bush did everything right. I'm not saying that. Who am I to judge what a president does? I wouldn't want the job if they gave me millions of dollars to do it. I mean, but it was a blame game. Blame him, blame him, blame him, blame him. This is, we inherited this. Well, they forget what George inherited. We got this and we got that. It's a blame game. Christians play the same thing. It's a blame game. We blame other people for our failures and our faults. Come on now. It's so easy to do that. Well, if they hadn't done this, I wouldn't be in the shape that I'm in. Or if they'd have treated me better, I'd have stayed at the church. Or if someone had noticed me and paid some attention to me. And well, see, it ain't about, as Jennifer said a while ago, it's not about you. It's not about me. It's about the kingdom of God. It's about Jesus Christ. It's about, if I'm not mistaken, the book lets us know that if we'll lift him up, he'll draw all men. Oh, Jesus. So we're here to lift him up.
Amen.
I'm not here to lift you up. I'm here to lift him up.
Amen.
And if you allow him to be lifted up in you, you'll automatically be lifted up. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Huh?
Amen.
And God has a way of exalting those that need to be exalted and a way of abasing those that need to be abased. He knows how to keep you up and he knows how to put you down.
Yes, he does.
He knows exactly how to put us in our place.
Amen.
So we need to start really thinking about the decisions and the choices that we make in life. Some of you are suffering from decisions and choices you made years ago. And it's got you in a certain shape now. Maybe you quit school and you've never furthered your education. Let me tell you something, it's not too late. The Bible college that I work with, we also do high school programs. It's not GEDs, it is a high school diploma. We had a lady got her high school diploma and she was 75 years old.
Thank you, Lord.
And then went on to get her bachelor's degree in college.
God bless her.
Amen. It's never too late.
That's right.
About the time you think you've blown it, God gives a revelation that there's a brand new opening for you. Hallelujah. And that bad decision you make, you can turn around and make a good decision. Huh? I can get you a high school, if you don't have one, I can get you a high school education. And it's so cheap, it's unreal. And it's legitimate. It is legitimate. Colleges take our high school diplomas, recognizes them. My son, when he graduated from we call it Kingsword Academy. When he graduated Kingsword Academy, he wanted to go to Oral Roberts University. We took him out to Oklahoma, out to Tulsa, and went to ORU and did a tour of the campus and went in and sat down. And we found out that he could go to school there practically free, not costing us anything. He could get grants and all kinds of stuff to school, and even had an opportunity to go on as a walk-on on their basketball team. And he wouldn't go because it's too far from home. But they would have taken him. That's how thorough and how well-known the school is. across the country. So what I'm saying is this, you can change your bad decision and end up making a good decision. Some of us in life made a bad decision of who our mate was going to be. Come on now. We sure did. We sure did. See, I can tell if you're in love or if you're in lust. It's very, very easy. If have you noticed that as the years go by, things shift? Some things disappear and other things appear. Now, if you can stay with it when that great paradigm shift takes place, you're in love. But if you start looking around after that shift, you're in lust. Come on now. Because ain't none of us stayed the same since we got married. Come on now.
Amen.
You might as well say amen. It's the cold, hard truth anyhow. Huh? Some of us got better looking with age. I didn't say I did. I just said some of us did.
See? You didn't look at mine, did you? Yeah.
Some of us aren't faring so well. But there's been a change. A change.
Absolutely.
And most of those changes have been based on decisions that we've made up to this point.
Yep.
Right?
Right.
So success is coming to the place where you begin to make right decisions. They may not seem right, but there are right decisions. But they're going to cost you something. A right decision is going to cost you something, just as a bad decision is going to cost you something.
Sure.
Amen? And we've got to quit blaming everybody else for our downfall.
Amen.
We can't blame the government for the shape we're in right now. I'm talking about personally now. I'm not, nation-wise, we may can, but we can't do it on a personal basis. Huh? I mean, we're all a product of what we eat. I mean, if your arteries are clogged, it's not my fault. I know you're not enjoying this just yet, but it'll be all right. If your arteries are clogged, it's not my fault. It's no one else's fault. But yours. Huh? And now God's not healing me. How come? Because you're not doing anything to receive healing. You made the choice. Now you got to live with it. I was thinking tonight, I looked over at you and I thought, you know what? June looks better now than she did before she ever got sick. She does. I'm not saying she looked bad then. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying when that sickness hit her and the doctor said, no, you ain't got that much time left. She what? You done gone, what, 2 years past that time? Almost 2 years past that time. She looks healthier now than she's ever looked since I've known her.
Yeah.
Amen. Her color's good. But you know what? She made a decision to live and not lay down and die.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Decided to get up and not feel sorry for herself and know that her God has everything under control.
Hallelujah.
And he's bigger than the big C.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Made a decision.
Yes.
I'm going to hang in there.
Uh-huh.
You all ain't getting rid of me that easy. Hallelujah. You got to deal with me for a while longer. Glory to God. She'll be here when she's 99 years old. And then we'll give her another year so she can make the century mark. May have to have a little help. That's why I married someone younger than me, so I can have the help. Because I figure after it goes a little farther along in life, I may need to be pushed around. I'm used to that. I've been pushed around all my life. Decisions. Can you think back at the last time you made a bad decision?
Oh, yeah.
Well, yesterday maybe. It could be as soon as that. I mean, wouldn't you like to have some years back and done a better job with your kids?
Yes, I would.
Would you?
Sure.
Honestly, we were all practicing parents. That's why we treat our grandkids differently.
So true.
Yeah, we know better. If we had only known it then, we could have saved our kids a lot of hardships and heartaches. We wouldn't have beat them nearly to death as we did then. We'd have had some mercy. My mama used to always tell me, because I grew up without a dad, but my mama always told me, "This hurts me worse than it does you." And I'm like, "The devil is a lie. It ain't your butt burning." And then I found out when I got older and I had my own children, there is a hurt to it. It's different than the burning of the rear end, but there is a hurt that comes into the heart of a parent that have to do that kind of stuff.
Absolutely.
Huh? Some of us, if we could go back in time, we would have got married as soon as we did.
Right.
That's right.
So, boy, there was a big amen back there. I mean, seriously, think about it. How old was I when I got married? 19, I think. 19. How old were you? How old were you?
25.
Well, you're a smart man. How old were you? 18?
2 weeks after I turned 18.
2 weeks after you turned 18.
I was
15. 15? Wow. How many children do you have?
She looks good for 15, doesn't she?
Yes, she does. Yes, she does. How many children do you have?
Seven
children?
Yeah.
Wow.
I think there's four of my own. Three kids combined.
Well, I don't know, but that's still seven children.
That's right.
I don't care.
And then we got six.
You got six?
We got eight.
Yeah.
You got eight?
They're all mean, too.
Four was bad.
They're all mean?
Yeah, they're mean.
I wonder why.
I got one that I don't even talk about. I think God's got to deal with it. That's all it is.
And you know what? I think we all have one like that.
Yeah.
I'm serious.
We do.
I think you all have one like that?
Yeah, we have one like that.
Yeah, see, I've got one like that. And you just...
I can't understand this one. I really
you can't understand? How many children do you have?
Five.
Man, you all are a productive bunch, aren't you? You took God serious when he said multiply and replenish. I have seven myself.
My mom's mom and dad had 13 kids.
Huh?
My mom's mom and dad had 13
kids.
13
kids. Yeah. Oh, my gosh. Mine had 15.
Are you serious? So a lot of you came from big homes. Huh? Well, from the look of all of us, very few of them beat us to the table.
Me and Pat's got that door dash.
You got Jesus. What do you do with her?
Yeah, you want to see it?
So Mike, she just. Huh?
You want to see it?
No, that's okay. No, oh, that's okay. I don't need the visual.
That's what he did.
He caused that, didn't he?
Yes, he did. Yes.
He does that. He'll do that. He'll say, the Jordan. That's out of worship.
So she really can blame that on you.
Yes.
She can't blame the look on you, but she can blame the phrase on you.
Yes.
Success. Make decisions. Wow. Now, you made a decision to get the Jordash look.
I reckon I couldn't beat him. I might as well join him.
Oh, Jesus. I'm going to move on this, man.
You opened the door on that.
I knew we were going to have a good time tonight. I just want to talk to you tonight, really. That's what I want to do. We get too much preaching the way it is. Seriously. We get preached at too much. Why can't we just talk? See, during your choice making, when you have a setback in your life, anybody here ever had a setback? You've got one or two choices. You can either sit back or you can make a comeback. Comebacks can be tough. Maybe you've ever played sports and had an injury during a season of whatever sport it was you was in. And you blew a knee or broke a bone or whatever. The comeback was rough. You know, you had to take it slow and you had to do different exercises and all kinds of stuff just to make a comeback. John Maxwell said, your amount of determination is measured by what it takes to make you quit. It's for some of us, it doesn't take much of an attack from the enemy to make us throw up both hands and start grumbling. Now, you know I'm telling you the truth. Amen? So we got to make a decision. Our decision has got to be, is God really able?
Amen.
Was that a song Pastor Pat did tonight? My God can do
anything.
Do you really believe that?
Yes.
I mean, seriously, do you really believe that? Hallelujah! Not only can he does. Hallelujah! And I'm glad that he does. And I'm glad that I'm convinced that he does. Hallelujah! It's not a mental descent thing. It's in my heart, glory to God, that there's nothing too big for God. There's nothing that God cannot handle. There's nothing that God cannot pull us through if we can stand the pull. There's nothing that God cannot do even with our own stubborn self. He's bigger than what's the matter. He's more, a God of more than enough. Hallelujah. He's waiting on us to make up our mind that we know, that we know, we know, we know, that we know beyond a doubt that my God can do anything. Anytime.
Yes,
and he so desires to do it.
Amen. Yes,
hallelujah.
He can. Yes, he can.
Glory to God. Number two, what does it take to make a success? Being a doer of the word.
Amen.
James said, don't hear only, but do.
But do.
Practice the word. Practice the word. Listen to this. To be successful, you must become a doer of the word, not a hearer only. Don't be afraid to take risks or chances. Get out of the boat, even if it's storming. Remove yourself from your position like the four lepers had to do. Wow. There's a scripture in the Bible. I thought I was going to preach on this week, but I'm not going to get there. But there's a scripture in the Bible where David and the Philistines had fought. The Philistines would win, and then David would win, and the Philistines would win, and David would win. And then the Philistines came back. And David was praying and asking God if he could go after the Philistines again. And God told him, he said, no, you just sit here. And he said, and you listen real closely. And he said, don't go until you hear the sound of going in the mulberry trees. Amen. That intrigued me here a while back. And I got to thinking, what is a sound of going? What is he saying, a sound of going? In the Hebrew, the sound of going means a sound of cadence or a sound of marching. So God was telling him, David, you don't go till you hear heaven's march, till you hear heaven marching. And you'll know that I went before you. And the enemy would be destroyed by the time you get there. Hallelujah! Some of us need to just sit still a little bit and wait on that sound and then do what that sound is begging us to do or promoting us to do. Just listen and go. That still small voice. I like it when we don't get loud sometimes, because sometimes God's not in the thunder. Sometimes he's not in the wind. Sometimes he's not in the fire. But he's just in a still small voice. Hallelujah. But a voice like none other voice. Aren't you glad? And that voice will bring you instructions. And then we become a doer of that voice.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. And you can never go wrong when you know that God has went before you.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Don't try to get ahead of God.
Oh no.
Let him go before you. Amen. He said, well, I don't think we can get. Yeah, you can too. You can get ahead of God.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. God's still staying right here. And we're moving on. And God is saying, hey, y'all, where are you going? It's not time to move yet. Get yourself back here. Because you're not going to be a success until I go before you.
Amen.
Oh. See, I'm glad that the God I serve goes before me and takes care of the enemy before I get there. Matter of fact, I've learned this. I don't even have to fight the enemy. Why should I fight him? He's under my feet. I said, he's under my feet. He's already been defeated. Why should I let him out from underneath my feet and cause a fight all over again when he's fought and he lost the fight? Hallelujah. Why? Because God went before me. Jesus went before each and every one of us and defeated him. Hallelujah. And when we were birthed into the kingdom, we were birthed in victory. We just need to learn to walk in it. That's our problem. We need to learn to walk in the victory that he gave to us. Some of us still believe what the devil will say to us at times. Don't we? I mean, we even got enough sense to know when we'll testify and say, well, the devil told me this and the devil told me that. Wait, hold on, dude. If the devil's talking to you, and you know he's talking to you, first of all, he has no business talking to you. But if you got enough sense to know he's talking to you, why don't you have enough sense to know you're not supposed to listen? And everybody knows the devil is what? The father of what?
He's
the father of all lies. And yet, we'll get disgusted over what he just told us. Well, you know, I mean, if he says you're going to die, that must mean you're going to live. He ain't going to tell the truth.
No.
When he tells you you're unhealthy, that must mean you're healthy. But you got to learn to walk in health. Remember, he said, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in what? Health. He wants you to have good health. He wants you to walk in good health. Hallelujah. So we hear the word, we hear the voice of God, and then we become a doer of what that voice is saying. I've learned this the hard way. I used to carry hurt. Anybody here ever carry hurt? Somebody hurt you, and you just carry it. I even carried it when I really wanted to get rid of it, but I still carried it. Amen. Till I woke up one day and realized that the person I'm carrying it against is having a good old time in life. They're laughing and carrying on, and I'm miserable. And if I'm still carrying it, then I have not extended forgiveness. God gave me a great lesson about forgiveness years ago. I may have shared this here before. But I had a preacher who came against me hard out in California. I was living in Long Beach at the time. And there was a man that promised our ministry a lot of money. I mean, a lot of money. This was in 1982. A bunch of money. In the tune of about $100,000. And there was a pastor that I knew out there. He and I came up under the same church in Indianapolis when we were kid preachers. That man was in his church. He didn't like it that man was going to bless my ministry. So he got a hold of that guy and told him that if he blessed me like that, he was no longer welcome in his church. And then he called me and told me that if I took the blessing, he would blackball me with all the preachers in California. I hated that man because I didn't get the money. He stood up in front of his congregation of about 400 people and told them, if anybody here gives a dollar to Mike Baldock or to his ministries, you'll no longer be recognized as a member of this church.
They do that sometimes.
Yeah. I hate him. Now, you can understand why I would hate him. Surely. I mean, destroyed an opportunity that I had to get on the ground floor of TBN and the ground floor of some of the great ministers you know about now. I had that opportunity and taken away from me. I found out years later why it was taken away from me. God was really in that thing. Wasn't handled right, but God was in it. He didn't want me to get hooked up that way anyway. Because God let me know that anything I do in the ministry, he's going to get the glory for it. And no man's going to say they did it in Mike Baldock's where he's at because of me. That's why I live by faith. So every time that man's name was mentioned, oh my gosh, I would cringe. I'd want to tell someone the story of what he did. And I carried hatred. I mean, I was preaching, but I carried hatred in my heart. One day God told me, he said, you know you have to forgive him. Here's what I told God. I said, I'm not going to forgive him. I don't want to forgive him. He doesn't deserve to be forgiven. God said, okay, but you got to forgive him. I'm like, okay, God, but I'm not going to. Oh, I was in rebellion. I said, I'm not going to. About 10 years later, I was pastoring a church in Indianapolis on the west side, out close to the airport. And I got a call on a, I think it was a Monday. I got a phone call, and it was from him. He said, "Mike, let me go back a little bit. I told the Lord, I said, if I got to forgive him, you're going to teach me how to do it, because I don't want to do it, and I don't even know how to." And the Lord said, "Well, when his name is mentioned, you just say to yourself, I love him with the love of God in the name of Jesus." So when his name would be mentioned, hatred would come up inside of me, and then inside of me I'd say, "I love him with the love of God in the name of Jesus." So he called me on Monday, about 10 years after that, called me. He said, "Mike," he said, "I need some help." He said, "I've moved back to Indianapolis." He said, "I know you know a lot of preachers." I was, at that time of my ministry, I was heavily involved in a TV ministry and did know a lot of folks, and was involved with TBN at the time, and had a fairly good name in the Midwest, and a fairly known name in the Midwest. And he said, "I know you know a lot of people." He said, "I'm starting from ground zero. Can you help me?" I said, "Well, how can I help you?" He said, "Would you give me a letter of recommendation to some pastors?" Now, here's the thing. The guy could preach. As far as preaching and delivering the word, he was excellent. He was good. Here's what I told him. I said, "I'll tell you what. I'll give you a list of pastors. I'll write a letter of recommendation. And why don't you just come and preach for me Sunday?" I knew then that I had truly forgiven him. And God let me know how to do it, and I became a partaker of his word, and it took me into an area of forgiveness. If I can do it, you can do it. Hallelujah. It's available there, but you got to partake in the word. You got to see, God knows our foolishness. When we say we're not going to do anything, do you think that upsets God? He just finds another angle.
That's all.
I mean, he'll get you one way or the other.
That's right.
You're not going to get it over on him. He'll find a way. He'll sneak in somewhere. Yeah. But he'll get there.
Yeah.
He'll get there. So we got to become doers. Doers of the word. Doers of the word brings us to a life of success. A life of success. Okay? Next. Success is being determined. Remaining determined. No matter how bad things get, you're still determined to make it. I like what Caleb said. "I was 40 years old when I saw this mountain. Now, 45 years later, I'm 85, and give me this mountain." He was full of determination. You're not going to take the promises of God away from me. Hallelujah. I'm standing firm on that. I'm determined to make it through. Come hell or high water, I'm going to make it through. It's not if it's the will of God, because I know what the will of God is. I'm going to make it. Glory to God. I've made up my mind, and Marilyn Hickey calls it bulldog faith. Man, I've clamped down on the promises of God, and I'm not about to let go of them. Be determined. Determination brings good success. But you got to be determined. Don't you think there were some days for June?
Oh, Jesus.
That she was weak?
Sure.
Feeble? And I thought, man, what's the use? Don't you think there was days that crossed her mind? Had to be. The things that they do, Brother Ronnie was telling me the other night, he said, "Mike, it's not the chemo that gets me." He says, "It's that shot that I get 2 days afterwards." He said, "It just drains me of all my strength." Well, now you know as well as I do that when you're weak, it's like, oh man, I don't know if I can make this or not. I just like to, sometimes I hurt so bad. I hurt so bad today, and I was sitting down in an easy chair just hurting almost to tears today. It was that bad for me today. And I'm like, I don't know if I can go another mile or not. And then all of a sudden I thought, no, I got a job to do.
Gotta do it. Yeah, you got to do it.
Yeah. And I don't care how bad I hurt. If I got to crawl on all fours, I'm going to do what God's called me to do.
Yeah.
Devil, you ain't getting me this way.
Hallelujah.
It may hurt. But it's not going to hurt any more being in church than it is me sitting where I'm sitting.
That's right. It's a church.
Hallelujah.
It's a church.
Amen. So just get up and go, because the only time you really got relief is under the anointing anyhow.
Amen.
So why not go and get under the anointing and get some relief for a little while? We'll just do that, and then if we hurt later, we'll just hurt later, but we'll do it all over again tomorrow. Hallelujah!
Yeah.
You've got to remain determined.
Strong.
There is no way you'll ever backslide if you have determination in your life.
That's right.
No way. No way. Got to keep like that little train. What did he say? I think I can. I just did. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Woo! And about the time you think you can't, you've already reached the top, and you say, glory to God, I've already done it. Hallelujah. Didn't think I could, but I did. Glory to God. And now it's gave me enough strength to climb one more mountain, go through one more valley. Hallelujah. Aren't you glad? Because
yeah.
I'm determined.
Yeah.
We need to get as stubborn in our faith as we do in our flesh somehow.
Oh,
you're not talking me out of this. Remember what Elisha said? Don't say that. Don't speak that. Hallelujah. I'm not buying that garbage. Hallelujah. Because it's already been proven that I can do it, because I have done it.
Yeah.
Once you do it and you know you can do it again and again and again and again. You might fall down. What is it? A good man falls down 7 times, but he keeps getting right back up. Hallelujah. You may not be down, but I'm going to get right back up. Hallelujah. It's took me a lot of years, but I've learned not to wallow in my knockdown times. Just get back up. Get back up. It's going to hurt whether you're down. It's going to hurt whether you're up. So you might as well just get back up. Ain't nobody going to feel sorry for you when you're down. But they're more able to, they're more likely to help you when you're up.
True.
Because they'll see the determination. I'll help someone that's determined. But there's some folk you can't help because they don't have a spirit of determination about them. Come on. I learned that in pastoring churches. You can't cancel that kind of spirit. People either got to get determined or not. And if you want something bad enough, you get determined to get it. The determination is, how bad do you want it?
Amen.
That determination will bring you a life of success. Hallelujah. Let me go to another, because I got something I want to do here before we leave tonight. Let me go to another. Oh, this is a good one. Success involves sacrifice. Sacrifice involves commitment. Commitment are the difference from those who do, from those who don't, from those who have, from those who wish they had. Sacrifice, making a commitment. Hallelujah. I'm going to go. I don't care what happens. I'm going. I'm going.
Yes, sir.
I'm going. I ain't missing church. Unless I just ask. There's sometimes you have to.
Right.
I understand that. I know. I mean, you can't lose your job. God doesn't want that. That's not the will of God. I mean, tell your boss, well, I'm going to church. I don't care what you do. You fire me. Well, you probably get fired. Then you'll be coming to the church crying and wanting us to pray that you get another job.
Yeah.
Well, you shouldn't have left the one you had.
Amen.
Hello.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
But it's going to cost you something. Listen, it didn't cost you anything to get saved, but it's going to cost you something to stay saved.
Amen.
You hear me?
Yes, sir.
It's going to cost you something.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Yes, it is. It's cost missionaries their lives.
Huh? Absolutely.
It's cost some people their homes.
Yes.
Honestly. It's cost some people money. It's cost some people their families. What Jesus said, unless you forsake your father and your mother, all that stuff there, houses and lands. Whew.
Take up your cross. Follow me.
Take up that cross. Your particular cross. And follow me. Peter, throw down your fishing nets. And I'll make you fishers of men.
Fishers of men.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Something bigger than you.
I'll teach you something to do that you can never learn to do on your own. And you're going to love it. Hallelujah. I'll make you what you were born to be.
Yes, Lord.
Oh, glory to God.
Yes, Lord.
I don't want someone, if I go by the way of the coffin, I don't want someone walking by my coffin. I've done the same thing. Walk by and say, boy, don't they look good? How good can you look when you're dead? I mean, yeah, but that's only because of the undertaker was good with the makeup. Yeah, that's the only reason why. Huh?
Your suffering is gone too.
Yeah, that's gone. So you don't have that on there. But I don't want them to say I look good. I told Julie, I said, I want a spring put on my right elbow, and I want a little trip switch right there by the head of the casket. And when they come by and you're standing there and they say, don't you look good, I want you to hit that switch so I can just... Well, wouldn't that shock the snot out of somebody?
It's
the way my mind works. I used to do a lot of funerals for Wilson St. Pierre there in Fountain Square. I was on their call board, and they'd call me a lot. But, matter of fact, I did a funeral there one time, and there wasn't enough people that attended the funeral to have pallbearers. I had to be a pallbearer. Now that's sad. That's sad. But I did a funeral one time. This young lady, she was 21 years old, and she had hung herself. She had a little baby, and I think the baby was like 5 months old or something like that, and she had hung herself. They came home and they found her in the garage. She had thrown an extension cord across the beam in the garage and sat on the hood of the car and scooted herself off, and she hung until she was dead. So they want me to do the funeral. I'm not laughing because she was dead, but this is funny. They want me to do the funeral. So I asked him, I said, what do you want? I'll do anything. Just her mom was real, she said, make it short. I'll make it as short as possible. So that night, I spent that whole evening with them at the show. The next day for the funeral, I walk in. Bob St. Pierre gets me. Did you know Bob? Bob St. Pierre got me. He said, Mike, come here. I said, what? What's going on? He said, I want to tell you what just happened. I said, what? Her name was Glenda. He said, Glenda's brother came up to me just a moment ago. She had a huge bruise right here from that extension cord. Well, that's the left side, so it's on the inside of the coffin. So you'd have to lean way over to see it. And he said, her brother just came to me and said, Bob, can you do something about it? He said, Glenda moved her head in the middle of the night. And you can see that thing on her neck.
Oh my God.
Bob Stankbeer said, Mike, I loaded her up with stuff. I know she's dead. But if she moved, I'm getting out of the business. I said, I ain't doing the funeral either, brother. That's a true story, man. If she moved, I ain't preaching no funeral. Sacrifices in the ministry. Sacrifices in your own personal life. Sacrifices. My children went through a lot of sacrifices. And me coming up through the ministry. And that's hurt some of them. If I had to do over, I'd have done things differently with my family. But my family, since I've been in the ministry, I've been to 2 family reunions in 40 years. Because they normally have them on Sunday.
Right.
You know, we used to teach and preach, don't work on Sunday. Well, preachers work harder on Sunday than they do any day of the week. I mean, it made no sense to me. Isn't that the truth? You know, I mean, have morning service, have an evening service, tired and wore out, and some goofball wants to talk to you for 45 minutes after church, and you're tired, don't want to stand here and talk. Now, if you want to talk to me tonight, don't think that I'm thinking you're a goofball. But if it goes past a half an hour, I may call you a goofball. sit there, you got to be so kind. I was thinking yesterday, preachers are like politicians. They have to shake hands and kiss babies. And you have to tell everybody their baby's pretty. Man, that's tough for me because I've seen some ugly babies. My daughter Tracy had the ugliest kids I ever seen in my life. I didn't want to call them my grandbabies. They so ugly. Here's a tricky quote: when the baby's ugly, you go, "Oh, ain't he or she cute?" They say that to really mean that's an ugly kid.
Yeah.
Because if they're really pretty, they'll say, "Boy, they're pretty."
Somebody said they had to tie a stick around their neck to get their dog
to play with.
Or a pork chop.
Or a pork chop. Sacrifices. And the greatest testimony of a sacrifice is shown in your commitment. It proves to others where you stand.
Yes.
Without it, you'll fall for anything. Yes. Commitment will keep you going, even when you don't know all the answers or the solution. Commitment will create persistence. Wow. There's got to be a commitment. Wow. Success is also, I'm gonna do this one more, and then I want to do something else. Success is also putting yourself in a God position. Now, what I mean by that is putting yourself in a position where God can move in your life. Putting yourself in a healing position. Putting yourself in a miracle position. Everybody wants a miracle, but no one wants to be in that territory. See what I'm saying? I mean, you got to have some bad stuff going on in order to be in a place for a miracle. Right? Whatever it may be.
Yeah.
You got to be doing without something, or some kind of chaos is taking place, or something's going on, a bad report or whatever. But see, that's when we should really praise God, because that's when we're in miracle territory.
Yeah.
Huh? You can't see a miracle without being in miracle territory.
That's true.
Amen. I didn't say it's pleasant, but it puts you in a place for a God opportunity. Well, listen to this. Opportunities come to those who are patient. It comes to those who are looking for them. And it comes to those who will continue to pursue their dreams and their visions. It comes to those who keep knocking, who keep seeking, who keep asking. And it comes to those who are not afraid to try new things using different methods. Wow. It happens.
Yes.
Last but not least, this isn't all of them, but last but not least, success is staying focused. Refusing to look to the left and refusing to look to the right, stay focused. Hallelujah. Keep your head square on your shoulders. Keep your eyes forward, your mind determined, your body willing. Hallelujah. And you will have good success. Can someone say praise the Lord?
Praise the Lord.
Okay, here's what I want you to do. Give me at least, surely there's at least three people that has a testimony that started last night with some kind of breakthrough that's beginning in your life. It doesn't have to be totally open yet, but it's started. It's already started. Can I get someone to testify that? Go ahead.
I tell you what, we started a new ministry. It's called Trucking for Jesus. Uh-huh. We've already taken one load of clothes to the Appalachian Mountains, and Sunday night we're leaving for Ashland, Montana. We got three more trips already planned to go. We're taking clothes. And after they house and feed 800 kids a day out there, we got that in there, and we got three more to go. We got one more tonight.
You're working with the Indian reservations and stuff, aren't you? Man, that's awesome. And God's making a way.
Amen.
See, that's incredible. Anybody else? Has this revival done anything for you?
Amen.
I have a new attitude.
Praise God. Now see, that's awesome. That's awesome. A new attitude, huh?
That was mine.
That was yours? You got a new attitude?
Try.
Well, that's good. You can't get there until you try.
That's right.
Amen. Anybody else? What's the revival done for you? Anything? Jesus, ain't no need of me coming back.
It makes you think more about Jesus and more about what you need to be doing.
Wow. Amen. That's awesome.
Yes, amen.
That's awesome. Yes.
Strengthen me spiritually and physically.
Wow. All right. See? Yes.
I found forgiveness after last night.
Did you?
I carried a lot of bitterness for
some
people, and God allowed me to forgive.
Awesome. Yes. Praise God. See, sometimes you think, oh man, that service wasn't nothing. You don't know what it's done.
That's right.
I quit measuring services by emotions.
Right.
You can't measure them by emotions.
That's right.
I mean, God's at work, and He worked tonight.
Yes.
And there's going to be great results coming out of what happened tonight.
Amen.
I'm telling you. I don't know about you, but it's encouraged me. Sometimes I got to look in the mirror and encourage myself.
Absolutely.
David said I had nobody around to encourage me.
That's right.
But I encouraged myself in the Lord. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Sometimes you just got to remind yourself where God's brought you from. Don't you?
Amen.
You just got to remind yourself when you were weak, I found out I was strong. Hallelujah. When I fell down, He was there to pick me up. Glory to God. When I was a dirty, no good sinner, He was there to forgive me and wash the sin away as far as the east is from the west. I'm no longer a sinner saved by grace, but I'm a brand new creation. Old things are passed away, and behold, all things have become new.
Glory.
Real quickly, anybody else? See, there's been results.
It's wonderful. Amen.
Been results. I love coming. This is my favorite place to preach. I mean that. I go to a lot of places, a lot of churches, and I have a good time everywhere I go, but this is my favorite place to preach. The only problem with coming here is the time's too short. Because it seems like we just get started and it's time to go home.
Time to go home.
Amen. But that's all right, as long as we get something accomplished while we're here.
That's right.
Take someone by the hand. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank You for Your holy word today. I thank You for the encouragement You brought to us, reminding us, God, to walk in Your word, reminding us, God, that You have success planned for each and every one of us. I pray tonight, Father, that everyone in this place will become what You designed them to become in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Create better attitudes. Create forgiveness. Create in our hearts, God, a determination to follow. Create in our hearts a determination to purpose ourselves in Your word and to do what Your word says do, that we're partakers of that word and live a life of anticipation and breakthrough every moment of our life. We call it done now in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. And we thank You and we praise You for it in Jesus' name. And everybody said amen.
Amen.
And amen. Give the Lord a hand of praise.